Well, good morning, everybody. My paper is titled Reconsidering State in Cinema, Tracking the Nationalist Careers of India's New Cinema Movements. Basically, yesterday, Jackie Stewart did something which inevitably sort of hits us with like a double whammy. She made a comparison between India's new cinema and the LA rebellion. Now, this is normally not done. It is not done for a number of reasons. A, because these comparisons are very hard to make historically. B, because such comparisons we think we can only just about make now as we start beginning to have exchanges. Apparently, the 20th century either never had or did not find conditions in order to have. And thirdly, I think most importantly, because any such comparison, such extraordinary comparison between two such unequal, typically would be historically mediated by the concept nation, right? The nation would exist as a mediator of any such initiatives, or it would exist as an interruption to any such initiatives. At any rate, the nation would be something you'd have to work through in order to understand what such comparisons might mean. It's not that such comparisons haven't been made before, but they have always been made in a tentative, complicated way. And it is the complications that I am trying to understand in this particular presentation. I'm saying this partly because the idea of a national cinema is something that, of course, we inherit from Europe, the famous European nationalist cinemas, but it is something that translated into Latin America, into certain other Asian countries, a lot better than the concept seems to have entered in India, which is, of course, ironic considering that India has a highly articulated tradition of the national politically. So why do we have a complication and why do we have a difficulty with the idea of a national cinema, and why has that term not worked in India is really primarily the topic that I'm going to discuss. Now, my paper is long. I'm going to read parts of it and extrapolate parts. And if I have time, I'm going to show you clips. One additional reason for why we go into this at all is because the new cinemas of India, sort of between the late 1960s through to the early 1980s, was a state intervention. Okay, it was a state intervention that existed at a certain point of time when state film development corporations and the National Film Development Corporation entered, along with a slew of other institutions like state film chambers of commerce and so on, to set up state projects. And it can be also, while you can target more or less when it began, you can also interestingly target when it more or less ended, and states moved from cinema to television as the articulated, if you like, medium of the state. So you have a kind of an interregnum when many state governments flirted with different degrees of success with the concept of new cinema. And it is that period which I want to talk about, because I think the idea of the national inside those cinemas often did not sit well with the state agenda. This begins with a conversation that took place in 1984, or perhaps a non-conversation that took place at that point of time. I begin this with a meeting that took place in 1984 in a living room in Bombay, when the then local filmmaker and one of India's best-known new cinema filmmakers, Kumar Shahani, had an unusual visitor dropping by, Malayalam director G. Aravindan. The two didn't know each other very well, and it did not seem that this changed very much during that evening. Aravindan was his taciturn self. Shahani didn't say much. And I do not know if the two ever spoke again beyond polite greetings. Nevertheless, the coming together on an evening of two major new cinema filmmakers at what was a significant moment in the career of both might have been something of a historic event, and there may have indeed been much to discuss between them had they had the vocabulary. Aravindan was 5 years older than Shahani, but both began making films at the same time. Uttarayanam and Maya Darpan were both made in 1974. Shahani had managed to make only one film since then, in the decade between 74 and 84, but it was a big one, the three-hour fiction film Tarang. This film was, I have elsewhere contended, an epic melodrama. It's a term that I have tried to use, and I'm going to say a little bit more about it with some famous epic melodramas. Within a specific tradition of a national melodrama made in Hindi, where family stands for nation, where class conflict is presented as internalized by a decaying feudal patriarchy. Can I have some water, please? where class conflict is presented as internalized by a decaying feudal patriarchy riven by opposing and embattled forms of bourgeois ambition. His most spectacular aspect was a melodramatic intervention in which a working class protagonist, Janaki, played by the movie star Smita Patil, becomes the mistress of her rich employer, another major movie star, Amol Palekar, letting the plot itself now transgress across the class divide and set up radically new polarities of the sort that the epic melodrama through this period of nationalism would have provided him. Aravindan, on the other hand, sitting across the table, had a far more prolific 1980s. After Uttarayanam, he had made no less than 5 films, Kanchan Sita, Thampu, Kumati, Estepan, and Pokuvel. This prolific output on his part had been possible mainly because of the generous support of a producer named K. Ravindran Nair, famous through the Indian independent cinema as the ultimate filmmaker's fantasy, a very rich man who reputedly financed anything that Aravindan wanted to make, expecting nothing in return. The Aravindan film that we knew in Bombay and Shahani would have known in Bombay was something he made just before that meeting, Estepan, which had already developed quite a following there, a story of a quasi-mythical figure played by the artist Rajan Kakanadan in a Christian fishing village in Kerala. The character has all kinds of virtues and magical powers ascribed to something of a Christ-like worker of miracles. To many viewers, it was the extraordinary confusion-inducing combination of religious iconography, pop music, tourism, garish calendar art colors, and artistic creativity that brought the film alive within an idiom that many had at that time come to be associated with as Gulf modernity inside Kerala. That was suffusing Kerala at that point of time. And it was widely read as perhaps the best of several films showing this new cultural practice. To the extent that the conversation between the two had any content, we might hesitantly describe it as about the national. It was at best a convoluted conversation as each skirted cautiously around the subject. Each appeared to view the other's place within the national with some curiosity and some envy even. To Aravindan, Shahani was a privileged Bombay-based Hindi filmmaker who could, for all his difficulties, still manage to make a 3-hour epic with major Hindi movie stars. Working on in Hindi appeared, in Aravindan's mind, to directly equate with the possibility of a nationwide audience. Shahani's further proximity to the Bombay headquartered NFDC, and thus also to related national and global festivals, stood in contrast to Aravindan's own somewhat peripheral location in distant Kerala. On the other hand, to Shahani, Aravindan, and the kind of financial support that he was getting in Kerala, to say nothing of a significant captive local audience, presented its own contrast to his own lack of access to any kind of creative regional or ethnic constituency. If Shahani could claim any kind of access to a national base, it might well have had to do, like the LA Rebellion, with what Nagisa Oshima, the Japanese filmmaker, had rather grandly claimed as another country entirely. A country that Vijay Renoir, he described as, he said he was a citizen of the communist country film. Aravindan's Kerala was at least slightly more tangible. This paper is largely inspired by the divide across that evening and across the table. This divide has, I shall show, hope to show, a long history, one that includes not just Kerala and Bombay and India, but it includes the third world, it includes Asia, it includes decolonization, and even Hollywood has a small role to play in it. In this part of my presentation, I'm going to make 5 brief propositions, and then I'll sort of skip through the rest of the presentation. In his classic reworking of the concept of a national cinema, the Australian theorist Tom O'Regan pivots the concept of internationalization on its head. Projects of nationhood, says O'Regan, are not just confined to governments in cultural, educational, civic policy, but necessarily include commercial enterprises, magazines and national newspapers, part of television and cinema. All of these diverse activities share with legal structures and political parties a vested interest in creating not just national markets, but cathartic, imagined communities that would sustain such markets. Seen like that, such an interest allows us to, I quote him, identify, assist, legitimate, polemicize, project, and otherwise create a space nationally and internationally for non-Hollywood filmmaking activity. Since all national cinema, in Reagan's sense of the term, attempts to do either some or all of this, he concludes that it may be necessary to see cinema not as an alternative to internationalization, but as one of its many manifestations. National cinemas, whether in the guise of a local film industry producing a variety of films or whatever the reason for why national cinemas say they exist, must be seen from their inception as vehicles for international integration. What does such a concept of the national, this kind of an idea of the national, in the diverse domains of commerce, education, and politics that only a cinema can coalesce, in the struggle for a more equitable alternative form of, as against an alternative to international integration, what does such a conception say to India? This is primarily the question I'm asking. I think there are 5 points I want to make. One, that India clearly does not have a national cinema. If it has any at all, it has several. Its curious history of imbrication into the national both interrogates the concept itself, and then, I mean, I think that the cinema interrogates the national in a way almost nothing else does. It's a basic kind of a contention I have, I'm trying to explore. And it does this with a diversity of economic, political, and cultural perspectives that may be unique to the cinema itself. Two, amongst the consequences of such a diversity of perspectives from where to interrogate the national, there is not only a kind of a lateral diversity of means of entering the national, but a kind of a vertical hierarchy of nationalisms, some of which are visible to the state, many of which are not. I think this is an important point as far as I'm concerned. This is a definitional diversity that's as much exemplified by the cinema as literally produced by it. The cinema's working over of the national in India opens up foundational questions around what I might now call the propensity of different Indian regions to national self-definition. Now, how many of these regions are capable of national self-definition is something their own cinema will ask. Now, further pivoted around their capacity to also become diverse alternative internationalisms, if O'Regan is right. These are in turn revealed as comprising layers, as I have suggested, from a top end of the international festival circuit and the cinematic auteur as a species of national artist, all the way down to semi-legal circuits involving migrant workforces and diasporic populations, and of course the entire digital universe of piracy and sharing and all of that. Three, this entire set then of regional histories appear in key operations to be sharply contrasted to their Indian precedent. There are of course some similarities between Indian nationalism and the diverse nationalisms that we've had since independence. For one, several regional states in India have had their own roster of state auteurs, and some of them we know, some of them we don't. Some of whom, not all, have also qualified for national duty. In other words, you get a regional artist who will become an Indian artist at the Cannes Film Festival, for example. On the other hand, it appears that India, as such, had never been invested in the rest of what Tom O'Regan speaks of as a national cinema. This was, it appears in hindsight, less because the idea of a national cinema was unappealing, but more because it was widely believed unviable. This is, I think, for me, an important sort of further issue that I think is arising with research. Several regional nationalisms appear to therefore bear similarities to their European counterparts in their struggle against Hollywood, except that now Hollywood is replaced inside India by the Hindi or to a lesser extent Tamil and Bengali cinemas. Four, across the divides that I have mentioned, there is also a peculiar commonality. The interruption to internationalization now occurs as a failure that India first faced right after the Second World War, and several Indian regions since then, of exhibitor capital, the kind of distribution economies, really speaking, that basically, you know, you might argue, pulled the plug on the national project. Across India, across regions of India, film exhibition has been the force that has yanked the plug from the national cinema's project because the capital that it has represented has, across the board again, been elusive to, at times even directly in conflict with, the state project. This has not yet been explained sufficiently, I think, in Indian cinema. But when the explanation does come, it may well feature a range of dubious state actors, such as migrants, refugees, and pirates, rather more centrally than official histories of the national cinema would care to admit. And finally, my last point, if so, then the really interesting comparative study ought to be three-pronged rather than two between, say, diverse regional nationalisms in India that use the Bombay Hindi cinema as something of the big other, as something like a third angle in the triangle, which is the way Hollywood works in Australia. Put like this, within India, Hindi cinema acts at once as opponent and as catalyst for regional initiatives, for producing other definitions of the international. In this, there's a further caveat, it's an important one, which is that what does separate Bombay's Hindi cinema from Hollywood in its role as the big other is the extent of the American state's intervention in Hollywood as against the absence of the Indian state in any similar investment, if you like, in the Hindi cinema. This is primarily the proposition, and I wanted to put my conclusions up front because I don't know how much time I'll get to say the rest. I want to now rewind this first part of the conversation to 30 years before this epic non-meeting between Shahani and Aravindan. To 1951, an important year for cinematic governance in India. Here I have spoken primarily about the S.K. Patil Film Inquiry Committee report and a series of other reports in which there is a tremendous anxiety that the Hindi cinema particularly presents to the Indian state. It is seen as a decline in taste, it is seen as a maladjusted industry, and there's a whole series of concerns involving dubious economies and dubious cultures that Bombay's Hindi cinema presents. I won't talk about this. But what I have done is, I have spent Speaks Off, which is sort of between 1946 and 1949, just a year before the committee, and figure out what was happening in the Hindi cinema at that point of time. I've actually looked at some of the big commercial hits. I mean, for example, Ramesh Saigal's Shaheed was the top hit of 1948, and Mehboob's Anmol Ghadi, which I can show you here, was the big top hit of 1946. These were the commercial hits in terms of the top 10 most popular films made. And it's actually worth asking as to what kind of films Bombay was making at the time when India was turning independent. I mean, what was really going on? I would have shown you clips, but I will show you later if there is time. But I think that there are certain easy conclusions that can be drawn in a period which at that time the Indian state more or less across the board saw as a low period when there was a decline in taste on the one hand, and of course retrospective reconstructions of this period as nothing less than the golden era of the Hindi film melodrama. The first conclusion is that a lot of these films were made by independent entrepreneurs. The arrival of such an independent entrepreneur who made many of these films, or what producer M.D. Chatterjee would characterize the domination of single individuals mode in his keynote presentation at the Sangeet Natak Academy's film seminar of 1956, defined the change as one of individuals running the show, who got their finance from the only source available, namely private property, private parties, and goes on to say that so many producers are now operating in the red is due to a great degree to the fact that a major portion of the film rental is eaten up by the interest account. This particular change, which I think is an important predecessor change to the situation we are in and the sort of state intervention that we would now see, started from as early as 1942, and I think that's for me, okay, I want to rewind to that point. In the middle of the war, when major studios across India, at that time still doing very well financially, saw an inexplicable exodus of key directors walking away to set up independent startups, in today's sense of the term. So V. Shantaram quits the Prabhat studio in August of 1942 to launch a distribution concern, interestingly. And then he, of course, rents studio space from the Wadias, and he's funded by, as the biographer has it, a Delhi-based financier named Gupta. Mehboob Khan leaves the Sagar Film Company to set up another entity behind in some chawls in Bandra, supported by, according to his biographer, Bunny Rubin, a man named Lalaji of Manoranjan Pictures, also from Delhi. The shadowy entry of mysterious men such as Gupta and Lalaji, anonymous financiers willing to bankroll new entrepreneurs, is of course the first really important change we're talking about. The second is rather more interesting and rather more fascinating. 1947 is the year when, what happens in 1947? When Raj Kapoor and Dilip Kumar make their film debuts. It's fascinatingly interesting to see what independence looks like from Dilip Kumar and Raj Kapoor's cinematic point of view. Because I think what happens is that they both provide a certain testimony, autobiographical and filmic, to the fact that independence was not an easy transition. Indeed, what happens in film after film, both in Anmol Ghadi and in Shaheed, is an idea of the national in which happiness cannot be achieved in this new space. It has to be achieved either by going away, you have to leave this country somewhere, or as happens in Shaheed, you have to actually only find happiness in the afterlife. You know, it just cannot be done in this world. So it ends with basically Dilip Kumar being martyred and Kamini Kaushal then dying as she falls, and the two dead bodies are what the Indian flag is. I can show you that, but time is short. If India's independent cinema, and by independent I now mean produced by independent producers at this point of time, was more accurately a cinema about partition than it ever was about the freedom struggle, another argument I've made elsewhere, the Indian state's own attitude to its movies may well be unique to world cinema history. No other formerly third world country had a movie history of this scale preceding its own political independence. Whereas to most third world countries, certainly across Latin America and many parts of Asia and Africa, the setting up of indigenous popular cinematic cultures capable of withstanding Hollywood would have been something of a priority for realizing independence. India, which possessed such a cinema in Bombay, remained at best skeptical about this astonishing gift horse. This suspicion was apparently mutual if you look at these great melodramas, the epic melodramas that we're talking about. If independent India's state did not think much of its popular cinema, it often appears that the cinema did not think much of India's independence. Further underscoring the textual disconnect was a second bizarre instance, what I can only call economic secession. Historically, it has appeared that the greater the crisis facing the Indian economy, the higher the investment entering its cinema. So was this then a textual problem or was it an economic problem? Or is it that the Patil report was arguing, as the Indian state has always done, that the two are connected, that there's a connection between bad taste and bad money? In bringing the two together, in assuming that if you solved one problem, the other would automatically solve itself, what was being imagined in the Patil report was a combination of industrial production mapping itself on textual work to create a new kind of industrial textual practice that might incarnate a new film-going subject as a model citizen. Given that this effort at reform was happening at a very specific historical juncture where several post-colonial nations from Japan to the Soviet Union were attempting to implement Hollywood modes under the aegis of the state, it appeared that Hollywood may well be playing a considerably more central role, if an unusual one, in mediating all this than is usually recognized. We may well see the origins then, I'm skipping a bit, of such national regulation as something that would only come to fruition with the regional national cinemas in the Kannada, the Malayalam and other regional cinemas through the 70s, 60s, 70s and 80s. We can do more. We can actually read here in this period I'm talking about an unclaimed ancestry of regulatory frameworks in the Hindi cinema's troubled and delegitimized relations to the Indian state. I think that if we read the Patil report and those melodramas thus, even as it allows us the unpacking of the Hindi cinema's location in Bombay, it also allows us a location of political regional oppositions different from the usual ones attributed to regionalism, the ideologies of regionalism, and the equally problematic further attribution to regional separatism. This then was Bombay, Shahani's Bombay, the Bombay that was on one side of the table. Let us now turn to another side of the story, to Aravindan's Kerala. Within most conventional histories, the first part, if you like, of India's regional national cinemas the golden era, is a happy phase. I mean, this is a contrast to Bombay, where this is not seen as a happy phase, but really a tragic phase, where a number of the famous black and white melodramas were made. I'm thinking of the Gujarati film Mehendi Rang Lagyo by Manhar Raskapoor in 1960, Mudiya Naya Putran in Malayalam in 1961, or the Odia film Malajanha, 1965. This mellow golden era effect of the time would soon be set in contrast to the far more fraught situation that would now arise with the arrival of the new cinema movements. Now, in this section, I primarily made an argument that the 1970s did see new cinema initiatives that were fully formed state initiatives. In other words, state development corporations like industrial initiatives. So you actually had a slew of projects from state film chambers of commerce and so on, including distribution initiatives, film subsidies, and so on, which actually must be seen as properly state initiatives. And these are initiatives that did see a great deal of success. You did get a number of major film auteurs, particularly, I suppose, in Kannada, Malayalam, Odisha, Punjab, in the Northeast, in Manipur, and so on. You got a number of filmmakers who were auteurs. You started getting the pioneers, the Jyoti Prasad Agarwalas or the Gubbi Veeranas, whose anniversaries then started getting celebrated as the 50 years, the 100 years, or whatever, of these different industries. And you started getting regional filmographies and so on. Soon enough, however, this phase would run into trouble of the kind that the golden era had apparently avoided. Now, this is an interesting kind of a parallel which I think must exist in a number of regional cinemas. The first blip on the radar was the failure of several Hyderabad-based studios, started with much fanfare during the 1970s to turn in a profit. On the other hand, despite the avoid loss-making, new investments continued to flow into the sector of the industry. It became clear, says S.V. Srinivas in his work on Hyderabad, that these investments were larger kind of to do with rent-seeking side businesses whose value grew with the appreciation of real estate prices of offsetting their failure to collect rent than it had to do with the cinema. A second common experience for several trajectories of state development was literally to do with mobility. Mobility of capital, followed closely by the extraordinary capacity of mobility by the cinema itself. Migration now, both domestic and international, was creating new categories of consumers, and with them more obscure but equally significant new avenues for investment. The most spectacular example is, of course, Kerala, whose Gulf migrants would soon be amongst the several that collectively provided an extraordinary Indian postscript to the former British colonial enterprise itself, of migrants moving now, like Tamil migrants to Southeast Asia. 5 minutes, yeah. Tamil migrants moving to Southeast Asia, you know, Gujarati migrants to Africa, and of course Punjabi migrants to Canada, and so on. By the mid-1980s, remittances from the Gulf had become an undisputed reality. In this time, there was, and the specific connection between that and the Gulf economy was something that, as Ratish Radhakrishnan suggests, made it almost necessary that government initiatives that were provided by the film industry were both A, not fulfilled, and B, as movie budgets went up, and this happens, I think, across the board. The many subsidies that state governments now offer are not seen to be tempting enough for the industry to allow itself to remain under the wings of the government. A number of movies are produced in the 1980s by banners run by partnerships that move from proprietary concerns from the traditionally rich. That is what General Pictures Ravi, for example, would represent, the kind of economy he came from, supported Arvindan, to those of the new rich who formed partnerships. By the early 1980s, the entire cinematic reform initiatives were more or less abandoned, as both the central and several state governments transfer their patronage to television. The extent of the failure and the frustration that had been responsible, is reflected by a statement made by Hrishikesh Mukherjee, nonetheless, I mean, one of the most influential figures in the commercially successful new cinema, speaking in his role as the chairman of the National Film Development Corporation and writing in the annual report of the NFDC's 1982-83-84 financial report, saying that unhealthy and underhand tendencies belonging in the big cities are a part of the national distribution and exhibition racket. And that until and unless one becomes a part of this racket, he's now saying that the state should actually become a part of the racket in order to be able to survive. It is practically impossible to operate profitably or otherwise in this area of film business. We feel that unless and until the culture that we are supporting to propagate good cinema is extended to areas of distribution and exhibition, Indian film will always remain a weak spot. This is NFDC's official position on the subject. So why did that happen? Why did this particular failure happen? I think that that's an interesting question for me at this point in time as one thinks back on the career of the national cinemas. Equally, why was it unanticipated in the 1970s with these major state interventions? Seen in one way, this was a new situation. Seen in another way, it is worth recalling that in most filmmaking countries with a rich production sector, the overhaul of distribution took place with the coming of sound, whereas in India, it might be only said to have happened now with the arrival of the multiplex. The collapse of distribution support had several curious and seemingly unrelated consequences. One consequence was the arrival of a straight ideological populism. The basic assumption that the distribution failure was simply that people were not interested in such films. Or did the economics impose a form that made certain kinds of films, such as what you saw yesterday afternoon, effectively undistributable? What was the state now to do about it? Surely, as former Karnataka Chief Minister J.H. Patel is supposed to have sarcastically asked, it is not the job of the state to teach makers thrown together at their otherwise uneventful meeting would soon take unexpected turns that neither might have quite anticipated. What did happen soon after was that General Pictures Ravi, the munificent producer with whom Arvindan had worked and made so many films through the 70s and early 80s, stopped funding him. And he indeed shifted his allegiances controversially to Adul Gopalakrishnan. Both Shahani and Arvindan thereafter went on to make the same number of feature films for the rest of their careers, namely four. To Arvindan, this was a significant slowing down of the pace of his 1980s work, and it would eventually take him even outside his native Kerala in search of work. To Shahani, despite his deeply fraught relationship with the much maligned National Film Development Corporation, it is a far more successful career than many would have thought possible in the early 1980s. Had they both known what was to come, there might have actually been something to talk about. Thank you.
These are some stray thoughts that I've been trying to connect as I follow the writings on Bengali and Malayalam films from the New Wave period. A significant part, the most critical part of these writings, inevitably addresses the question of politics and political cinema. In fact, it was the primacy of the question of politics that signals a moment of departure within the longer history of the Indian new cinema, which starts roughly with Satyajit Ray in 1955. Whereas in the first phase, the critical demand was for a proper reflection of Indian reality, and this criticism has been voiced at least since the 1930s, the new demand was for topicality, which is basically something that comes into the foreground in the middle of the 1960s. If Satyajit Ray was the figurehead of the first phase of the new cinema, symptomatically enough, it was he who became a prime target of the discourse around topicality. The Calcutta of street agitations and hunger marches was absent in his films. One of his closest aides in the Film Society movement wrote in 1966 Inside Sight and Sound. He became a favorite target for his political passivity, quote unquote, from around 1965. This appears in a series of articles. This could explain the uncharacteristic rebuttal that Ray sent to the Statesman, a daily, Calcutta English daily, in response to a discussion on Mrinal Sen's Akash Kushum. Ray wondered why the makers of the film would lay claim to topicality for a film that relates an age-old story. This is a well-known kind of episode. It's a curious episode of 38 letters published in a daily over one film. Ray joined the fray three times, arguing with increasing sarcasm about the vacuity of Akash Kushum's topical/contemporary value. It is not an accident that with Akash Kushum, Mrinal Sen adopted the reflexive Nouvelle Vague style for the first time. raised suspicion was that there was nothing novel about it. Indeed, topicality became an inescapable horizon for assessment of political worth as soon as the second wave, this, you know, the period under review in this workshop, started. The early 70s presented a historical juncture that seemed to demand an erasure of any hiatus between the unfolding political reality and the screen. A number of films, including films as topical as Mrinal Sen's Calcutta trilogy, found themselves at the center of controversy in the pages of film society journals and political periodicals as now, frontier, and mainstream. Owing to their alleged failure to reflect the exact moment in which they stood, this was the demand being made on the films. The economist and cultural critic Ashok Rudra wrote a sympathetic review of Mrinal Sen's Calcutta 71 in Frontier. You saw Frontier in Padatik, if you remember, the first film that we saw the day before yesterday. This was the sort of little magazine lying on the bed. So this is iconic. He wrote a sympathetic review, Ashok Rudra, but he still felt the film failed to capture 1971. This is just one example. Sen presents three stories from Manik Bandyopadhyay, Prabodh Sanyal, and Samuresh Bose under captions, and he presents them under captions 1933, 43, 53. They do not really refer to these particular moments in chronology, but weave a history of starvation and anger. Ashok Rudra wrote, I'm quoting, in Calcutta of 1971, there were no processions, but the film showed a number of scenes of procession, as you saw in Padatik also. Processions are a falsification, he said. Calcutta of 71 had left far behind the stage of processions. It had entered the phase of armed struggle. So this is almost, 6 months behind or something. So that is the contention. So topicality of that kind. The exact moment is missed, they would say. Chitra Bhash, a film society magazine, brought out a special issue on Calcutta 71. And there's a very useful survey of all kinds of responses to that film there. And there's also material outside that. If you look at these responses, the official print media, that almost everywhere, from Amrit Bazar Patrika to Jugantar, Amrita, Statesman, welcomed Calcutta 71, both in its form and content. It's a peculiar thing. The only exceptions were Ananda Bazar Patrika and Desh in Calcutta. Ananda Bazar is the largest selling Bengali daily, which objected to the film citing its partisan interest. The Film Society publications, on the other hand, were not entirely unanimous in their sort of appreciation. One such publication, Cholochinta, wrote about the last scene of Calcutta 71, where this young man who says that he's walking for 1,000 years, even though he's only 20 years old, is walking for 1,000 years, witnessing, privation and hunger and increasing frustration. This is actually 1,000 years, 20 years is a Jivanananda Das quote. It's an allusion to a poem. Anyway, so this particular Film Society left-wing kind of review says that, this young man appears at the end of Calcutta 71 and says, you have to find out who killed me. You have to find out what happened and you have to react. So this review sort of says, why doesn't the film name the killer? Who is killing and whom? We know who. Why doesn't the film name him? So that is the kind of response that you get. Many, including two veteran critics, these are quite senior critics at that time, Mrigankur Shekhar Rai and Kalpataru Sengupta, bemoan the absence of the 1960s in the story series. So there's 33, 43, 53, where is 60s? Because if it is 1960, 71, 60s have to be there. That's the argument. Since the field, one cannot have a clear idea of 1971 without showing the immediate past. A not so well-concealed question for the radical critic also was what to make of the benign censors, the national awards, FFC, Film Finance Corporation grants, the wide acceptance in the bourgeois press. So the suspicion was this. Wasn't it because something is left out from the picture? Wasn't that something militant action itself? In most films later considered to be representative of the period, topicality seems to be an unresolved question. Other than a few agitprop plays and a small body of fiction, that degree of immediacy was to remain elusive. One source of the arguments now seems to be an exclusive focus on what was understood as content. It is possible to show that form registered the moment more closely sometimes, and thus fulfilled the task of assimilating the spirit of the time with greater intensity. I hope to briefly illustrate it with some examples, if there is time. But a selective reference to Marxist literature, which was basically, if I can recollect correctly, Engels, Plekhanov, some Lenin, especially Lenin on Tolstoy, and so on, Christopher Caldwell and Ralph Fox, Mao at Yan'an Forum, and of course the Indian Marxist critical tradition from somebody like K. Damodaran in Kerala to Saroj Dutt in Bengal. So I'm not citing them right now because there's no time. But it can be shown that there is some kind of a uniformity of engagement with content. And an intuitive grasp of the efficacy of art did not leave scope for political consideration of form. There was consideration of form, but not a political consideration. This despite the fact that the very category of art cinema was premised on a formal difference from mainstream. The formal qualities of New Wave did not go unnoticed. Form was clearly noticed, but not considered as a political substance. It was difficult in that moment to accommodate the essentially removed position of the filmmaker, it seems. As an ally, as an observer at a distance, as someone who comes after the event, it was difficult to accommodate that figure. But some of the most enduring portrayals of the time came from observing the figure of the vacillating ally, one who does not know if he or she should be part of the action, one who is in the difficult location of the witness. Satyajit Ray's Pratidwandi, 1970, for example, has a protagonist experiencing an increasing degree of despair and anger, but still unable to find the certainty that his militant brother has. Pratidwandi allows the time to haunt the film rather than stage its enactment. The protagonist tends to merge with the physical setting, not stand against it in the perspectival sense. It provides an optic into history that one perhaps cannot have through the heroes of the revolution. Siddhartha, the principal character, evolves as a body outlined in motion, in streets, cafes, and public vehicles, in fragile stasis in office corridors, in moments of concentrated reaction, or etched against a backdrop of a city captured, this city is captured in pulses rather than as a landscape. So the landscape principle is kind of, you know, sort of displaced for this kind of representation. Pratidwandi is thoroughly engaged in politics at this level, but this would be invisible to criticism focused on the politics of diegetic figuration. So I'll just show you a few stills from Pratidwandi. Adversary in English. This is the same actor you saw in Padatik. To take the example of a different method of displacement, John Abraham's Evil Deeds of Cheriachan, but I'm referring to the film from my memory because the print is not available, saw it a long time back, 1979, presents the reality of agrarian unrest by shifting the focus to a character removed from the classes engaged in a battle. A character going insane as he hangs in suspended animation between clearly defined class identities. Jensen Joseph was saying yesterday how the earlier film, Donkey in a Brahmin Village that you saw, becomes political again through a logic of displacement. So this, just to cite one critic, on this question, Vasudevan Unni, writing in Deep Focus, says there were rumblings of peasant revolt in the Kuttanad region. The film presents a state of mind in the midst of this, not really the peasant revolt itself. No hero or villain, a comedian cast in the role so that the laugh is at the expense of the audience. This is his, sort of, I'm quoting him. The comedian cast in the role of Chiriya Chan is Adur Bhasi, which reminds of a much later film, Shuman Mukhopadhyay's Harbert, which is also curiously casts a comedian in the role of Harbert, who is actually the insane cousin to the Naxalite revolutionary. The whole film is built around him rather than the revolutionary himself. John Abraham himself says, a peasant revolt happened in Kuttanad. One section killed 6 people from the opposite side. They escaped. This, I'm quoting him from the Shaji K.N. book on Abraham. They escaped. One guy got caught up in all this. He was a petty bourgeois. He was my relative too. After this incident, he fled from the place and joined a seminary. This guilt feeling became the subject of the film. It is about mental conflicts in Chiriya Chan. But I had not planned to make the political context part of my film. I'm quoting Abraham. John Abraham's ideas on political cinema were really harsh, of course. He thought it was exploitative, no different from manipulative commercial cinema. It imposes ideology on people. The problem before a real artist, I'm quoting, is how to face this situation effectively. Capitalism attempts to exploit all his creative resistances. That is what happened to New Wave cinema. Now, these are extreme remarks, but it says something about diverging paths within the so-called large spectrum of political filmmaking. In the criticism in question, form was implicitly aligned with the subjective. There are many debates around this, but I'm just skipping the references. One does not find a distinction being made between form and style, or between these two and language, which must have facilitated the equation between form and the subjective. It looks ironic as we consider the fact that the avant-garde branch of the New Wave, represented by Manikol and Kumar Sahni, often found fault with a realist political film on the ground of its objectivity claim. Its attempt to capture reality measured on a positivist scale. The avant-garde came to propose subjectivity located in the structure of images and their connections. If you think of the very, very complex and intriguing kind of ideas that Manikol had about lensing, use of lenses. The subjective further was aligned with the contemplative, which created a special problem for the critics, by which I mean the political circle critics, left radical critics. In films such as Mrinal Sen's Padatik, you saw it, or Adur Gopalakrishnan's Mukhamukham, about 10 years later, the individual appeared to have lost the connection with the collective project. The character engaged in a contemplative inward process in such films suggested an opposition to action. So he seemed to betray the call to action by stopping in the middle of the track, as it were. Film itself has a reflection in the sense of unfolding as an unfolding process of thinking. Not just showing thinking, but itself as an unfolding. The essential other time of the image, which is also involved here, the essential other time of the image, could not be accommodated, it seems, in the discourse in question. It was not easy standing in those years and in that context. If you think of the Mukhamukham sort of debate, which was kind of widely panned by left-wing critics, here is an example by Vijay Krishnan. It's called Realizing Decadence, the review of Adur Gopalakrishnan's Mukhamukham. He says, Sridharan, the hero, is inexplicable in Mukhamukham. There is no politics since what we have is stagnation. So that's the point, that it stops. All contemplation inward process stops action. There are no people but the individual. So that is a corollary of this, of course, in many cases. The self-destructive political leader has become a tradition of the 1970s. So he cites films like Ashwathama, Nayataddi, Sheshakriya, and so on. But this has become a fashion. The artist in Mukhamukham is not a torch, not even a lightning, I'm quoting. He's just a stone with a walker's feet. Yes, a stone's stillness, a stone's detachment. So Sridharan, this Marxist leader, he just disappears in the middle of the film, then comes back, and nobody knows what happened to him in the intervening years, and he comes back as a silent, almost immobile kind of figure. So there's this other critic, Ravindran, who says similar things. I'll just skip the quotes for the sake of time. But He says, that's one line, says, questions are indirectly posed about the worth of the message, as the messenger is a passive and depressive figure. And then he says, why is it that the story of such a person cannot be described in simple narrative continuity? Because the question is not with narrative experimentation. The objection is, why should it not be explained what happened to Sridharan in the middle period? Because it's not explained in the film. C.S. Venkateshan, whose essays I've used widely here, writes about a special situation in Kerala. You know, he says that Kerala had the earliest instance of a Communist Party rule, it meant that by the 1970s, a palpable disillusionment with communist politics had set in, unlike places like Bengal, let's say. He explains the contemplative turn in Kabani Nadi Chuvanapol, the P.A. Baker film from 1975, and Atithi Kumaran, or even the process of withdrawal in Cheriachan. These are 75, 76, and 1979. Through this logic of disillusionment with a certain kind of radical politics in Kerala. Perhaps this could explain a slightly different context. Why Kabani Nadi, the P.A. Baker film, could take contemplation to a deeper filmic recess than Padatik, even though there are some, as Ashish has been telling us, there are obvious kind of, sort of connections between the two films. In Pratidwandi, this film, Kabani Nadi, Atithi, Cheriachan, or Mukhamukham, a possibility was created for contemplation itself, not just a contemplating character, but contemplation itself becoming the object. For this, the logic of action, explicable action, had to be abandoned to some extent. One remembers how Deluge called the French Nouvelle Vague Hitchcock-Marxian rather than Hitchcock-Hawksian, because that was their self-description, Hitchcock-Hawksian. He called them Hitchcock-Marxian. He found the third, or the mental image, this is his language, materializing itself in these films. The mental image itself is Marxian for him rather than the specific content of the film. In his Peircean language, affection is firstness, action is secondness, involving two. Action is always shot, counter shot, action, reaction, cause, effect, involving two, which sometimes he calls dual. So action is two, affection is one. Pure relations are thirdness, mental image. Well, simply put, it's not a character being anxious, but anxiety itself as your object of study. So if you have an image of suspense itself, like Hitchcock, rather than a character being sort of, anxious, then you are in the domain of pure relations. So he would say that this is where film, the mental image, or the third, comes to the sort of be constituted as an object. Contemplation brought about doubt. I'll not show anything else then. Contemplation brought about doubt. It was thought to be a luxury revolutionary action cannot afford. Ashok Rudra almost equates the hero's upper class shelter in Padatik with the privilege of inaction he enjoys in his retreat, leading to his doubt. The radical associates of the film, of the hero in the film, draw similar conclusions, if you remember. And a more curious metonymic connection, which I want to go into now, however, was drawn with filmic embellishment. The formal and subjective could be further equated with embellishment. There was a current of thinking underlying the discourse on political film that was founded on a suspicion of the film's intimate connection to seduction, money, star, image, publicity, rewards. The rough edges of the image and narration, noisy soundtrack, the amateur acting became hallmarks of political cinema in the 1960s and 70s, almost everywhere, with various degrees of self-awareness. Attention to formal perfection often meant conformity to film as an object of consumption. So John Abrams' objections to political cinema using film stars, or the radical criticism of Ray's Ashani Sanket, Distant Thunder, it was called in English in 1973 film, show a discomfort with exploration of formal sort of finesse. Ashwini Sanket, 1973, Ray's film, Satyajit Ray's film, is an illustrative case. Ray adapts a Bibhuti Bhushan Banerjee story to create this time a somber commentary on the 1943 Bengal famine. He started with Bibhuti Bhushan adaptations in 55. It appeared to be a violation of the very reality of the famine to the critics, that the film was shot in color. Let us remember, regional films had not made a decisive transition to color yet. There were sort of one or two sort of here and there, but no. Ashok Rudra calls it, I'm quoting, this is his language, the incredible and fantastic Ashwini Sanket, the prettiest lidification of man-made famine. His language, 1973. Several correspondences in Frontier found the film's color, beauty, lyricism a failure in faithful depiction. The Frontier Review had the title, Chocolate Cream Hunger. Called it Chocolate Cream Hunger. Not a specific use of it, but the very existence of color on the screen seemed objectionable. It seemed to violate the aesthetics of austerity that the left-wing culture espoused in general. The rape and retaliation seen in Ashwini Sanket is thus perceived as, I quote, redundant, except maybe for the director's desire to smear the screen with streams of Eastman color blood. That was a general tone of criticism for Ray, for at least 15 years or so. This is again a problem of overlooking the form, but from a different form of a different nature in the case of Pratidwandi, than in the case of Pratidwandi, sorry. Here, Ray moves close to the other formal option of political cinema, the parable. The charge that Ashwini Sanket distracts the eye from the grimness of the famine seems seriously at odds not only with the persistent use of violent images of suffering in the film, but with the didacticism of the narration, which marks a departure from his early realism, precisely because it presents scene after scene as enactments of hunger and the attendant dissolution of social ties. About the latter, Ray's attitude is ambivalent precisely because it also means the destruction of caste barriers. His positive response to the demand of political engagement took a hazardous route here. Color appears with a denomination, like space in Indian popular cinema, and the cutaways to nature seem distracting only when we ignore their allegorical purpose. These elements, and as well as the graphic compositions of hands, a series of hands I wanted to show you, but I'll just, there's no time, where length of time shows an unusual readiness in Ray to disengage statement from the mise-en-scene. Usually that doesn't happen with him. This line of thinking intuitively echoed a more global position on political cinema, or what was being called in certain quarters the third cinema. The important text in this discourse, one important, very important text, is Julio Garcia Espinosa's Towards an Imperfect Cinema, 67, 69, two versions. But I'll just skip that thing, because I would assume that you would know this whole debate of poor and imperfect cinema. Most Indian New Wave films, even when intuitively following the model of cinema, a cinema of rough edges, could not necessarily figure reflection as a process without the anchor of the person, which I would like to think is essential to the film's own temporality. Global alternatives could be found in the discursive essay film, to which Mrinal Sen came very close in the Calcutta series, beginning with the interview. But even Sen was thought to be indulging in the luxury of contemplation. Why was the figure of the made into a timeless character traveling through the decades of history? He should be anchored to the present. And this is, I mean, there are other examples where the same objection is raised. One could deflect this argument to the level of the image. I'll take 2 minutes. One could deflect this argument to the level of the image, a non-avowed stratum of film experience in the body of criticism. Perhaps a basic iconic sign of the revolutionary, the image that appears across regions of New Wave in Calcutta 71, Podatik, Pratidwandi, Kabani Nadi, Amarian, even in another stream, the middle road film, Rajinigandha, even there, if you remember Dinesh Thakur. This image, this figure, iconic sign of the revolutionary, the lean, bearded youth with long hair, itself took on a double charge of discontent and protest on the one hand, and anguished solitude on the other. The first charge could have come from the revolutionary ferment, but the second owes its origin to a wider geist, a spirit for which not every articulation was of protest. Alienation and solitude connected it with a cultural archetype of longer life. So if you think of the other parallel movements, Hungry Generation writers, Shakti Chattopadhyay being the iconic figure in Bengal, or the what Ratish Radhakrishnan has written extensively on, the kind of Janakya Samskarika Vedi figures like Surasu, Krishna Kumar, and John in Kerala, overlapping with the other side, the existential side, the Ovi Vijayan, Anand, M. Mukundan, Kakanandan figures, that this is actually a figure that can act easily kind of travel between two. So just you know what I'm getting at, but I got very bad images from indiancine.ma. So this is a it's not the screen, these are screenshots. I'm not criticizing indiancine.ma. I cannot. This is of course Amma Aryan. This is a Jukti Tokko Gappo. This is Kabani Nadi, T.V. Chandran himself. This is Devraj Rai in Calcutta 71. That's Devraj Rai again being just before being shot, and so on. That's Padatik. So all three panelists here would look like that till the late 1980s. So this two-way pull, what could resolve this two-way pull is theater. Theater could resolve the dilemma at the heart of the political evaluation of cinema we are talking about, between responding to the exact moment and speaking through the film's own time, between the revolutionary as singular interruption of history and as a historically more enduring form, traveling through the decades. It could do that by bringing performance to the foreground. New wave political cinema did adopt that method, partly as a legacy of the KPAC in Kerala or IPTA in Bengal, but more importantly, presented as an extension of cinematic response to orchestrated violence, nightmare, fantasy. Think of Interview, Calcutta 71, Chorus, Chukti Tokko, Kabani Nadi, Donkey in a Brahmin Village. You saw a lot of theater there. I'm leaving out Ghasiram Kotwal because it is all theater, but Amma Aryan, Atithi that had seen where the woman lies on the floor, and the policemen dance in masks. I had some still images, but there's no time. It should perhaps be called, it's over, perhaps be called a method using theater rather than formal construction, since it was not necessarily integrated into a totality, but rather had a life as experimentation proper. Perhaps the history of the new wave should bring theater back into play. Thank you.
What I liked about the papers was that while they were not textual, they were actually looking at what you could call the conditions of the possibility of textuality for new cinema. Ashish did that in relation to the state, the market, and the industry. And Moinak did that in relation to the critical discourse. You know, what is meant by critical discourse here is not merely the criticism which was written, but rather a kind of regime for seeing the films which begins to appear at this time. Is to just highlight some points which might open up a discussion, and after that we have probably another 15 minutes or so for a discussion. Now, to begin with, I felt while listening to the two papers that it would be interesting to think a little more about the category of national cinema and the category of new cinema as they become current in critical discourse in India. Now, I say this because I remember reading Adur Gopalakrishnan once say in an interview that the category of the new wave itself is the creation of some film journalists from Bombay, you know, like Bikke Karanjia, Bikram Singh, Iqbal Masood, people like that, and also people who wrote in English rather than in the regional Indian languages. So Adur Gopalakrishnan had a kind of skeptical relationship to this. But in opposition to that, or setting that aside, what he tried to put forward was his own version of a national cinema, like a true Indian cinema, which for him begins with Satyajit Ray. Yeah? And most of the Indian films are non-Indian, he actually says in this interview. So there is a different idea of Indian cinema which is actually being proposed. But taking on Ashish's idea of a diversity of nationalisms, this goes along with Adur Gopalakrishnan's invocation of a distinctive location. He says that South Indian cinema is different. And the difference of South Indian cinema is signposted in terms of the problems it would face when it is shown to global audiences. Like, if a South Indian film is shown to a Western audience, they would find it very peculiar. He is drawing on his conversation with Derek Malcolm here, because people are wearing single dhotis, and they're bare-chested, and they're eating with their hands. And so Adur Gopalakrishnan interestingly makes a case for similarities between cultures which have a winter and which have a certain kind of clothing and certain kinds of eating habits and everyday gestures, and this creating a kind of unfamiliarity. So this is one of the ways in which an idea of a location is beginning to be put forward in Adur Gopalakrishnan's interview. Now, I say this because while we think about the diversity of nationalisms and the diversity of senses of the nation, which Ashish very, very carefully charted out, in fact, he couldn't do that in as much detail in the presentation as he did in the paper, we also need to probably bring into the discussion the sense of national location that the filmmakers and the film audiences themselves have. Like the question of Hindi as the big other, for example. Now, it's absolutely a valid point, but if you look at the late 60s, early 70s, there, I'm sure people who research Malayalam cinema may have more things to say about this. The cinema which is often invoked as a point of contrast or as a point of challenge is Tamil. Like when the state begins to give subsidies, it is actually to take Malayalam cinema away from the clutches of Tamil productions. And also there is a question of Tamil taste, the taste which is actually put forward. And this has a kind of longer literary genealogy which I do not want to go into now. Now, Ashish took up this very, very important connection between the discourse on money, the money which goes into the production of cinema, the capital which operates in cinema, and the discourse on taste. And I think that is a very significant point that his paper tried to make. And here, placing the question of new cinema within a longer history which begins with the 1940s and extends till the 1980s, Ashish actually pointed out a set of shifting configurations, of which you have, of course, the moment of this mutual distrust and economic secession. Then you have the Patil Committee report. And, of course, the institutions which arise from the Patil Committee report, like the Film Finance Corporation, the NFDC, and, importantly, the FDII. And Adur Gopalakrishnan himself actually dates the new wave cinema in India to the time when FDII graduates come of age and begin to make films. So there is an interesting connection there which comes up between the question of money and the question of taste and the creation of institutions. Now, I tag this because this also complicates our perception of the relationship between state and what we see as the new wave cinema. Now, people like Adur Gopalakrishnan keep talking about governmental support quite a lot of the time. At the same time, the political discourse, if we can speak about a political discourse which is not directly political, but political in a more general sense, in its general anti-establishment or anti-hegemonic sense, then one could say that in spite of that anti-hegemonic or vaguely anti-state stance, there is also a deep engagement with the state and what it should do for cinema, and also some kind of normative expectations and normative assumptions about the state's role in culture. And I think this is interesting because Ashish also pointed out, drawing on Ratish's work, the connections between developmentalism and the time of what we now call the New Wave Cinema. So this complicates the question of politics, the space within which political arguments are made. Now, of course, we need to differentiate among New Wave Cinema, like John Abraham, for example, is distinctive here, but then John is actually a minority figure, you know, within this configuration of directors in Kerala at that time. Now, the very, very interesting point which Ashish actually makes in the paper and which he hinted at in the presentation and which he did not have time to adequately develop is the centrality of the failure of exhibitor capital and what he called the pulling the plug out of the New Wave Cinema. And there he poses a question which I think probably we need to talk more about in this session and the other sessions, like what kind of cinema does exhibitor capital support? You know, and this is a question which directly bridges or connects the economic and the question of taste. And I feel that this is important because the criticism of New Wave Cinema, which comes from both the left on account of its lack of communicability to people, and the right on account of its strangeness, its anarchism, etc., etc., both come from the same root. And that root may have actually a particular economic element which has a constitutive function. So that I would like to hear more comments on that. Now, this question of the political, of course, brings us to Moinak's paper, which is about critical discourse on new cinema. Here my comments are much more specifically confined to Kerala, also because Moinak detailed the Bengali context very, very well. Now, in Malayalam, this may be different from Bengal. With the coming of New Wave Cinema, you also begin to see the appearance of a new kind of film critic. This film critic is different from Corey Corden or Cynic or Nadir Shah or people like that who used to review films earlier. These are people who probably never wrote about cinema before. They were literary critics or sometimes intellectuals in a general sense of the term, and they probably did not have any specialized knowledge or specialized background in cinema scholarship. But, and I don't even know the breadth of their history of viewing at that time. But they were the spokespersons of what we could probably call a new kind of aesthetic regime, you know, like something which actually breaks with the way in which films are seen, something which would prompt a reading of the film as a kind of artwork, the grammar of which is missed out in the popular discourse of cinema. And this has roots in literature, in theater, in the writing on theater especially. Adur Gopalakrishnan himself produced Waiting for Godot. He translated Waiting for Godot. He was hugely influenced by people like G. Shankarapillai, C. N. Srikandan Nair. So was Aravindan by Kavalam in his later years. So there is some kind of connection which comes up there. But we should not make the mistake of seeing in this some kind of outdated idea of literary criticism, which searches for symbolism and meanings, like what Jensen was pointing out in John's comment on literary critical use of symbols in cinema, etc., etc. What we have here is what may properly be called an aesthetic regime. And I felt that Moinak's comments on the question of subjectivity and contemplation really goes to the heart of that new regime which begins to emerge, which works by breaking action in some sense, withdrawing from action, and you get this figure who is actually, you know, the last images which Moinak showed, where there is a kind of disconnect between the figure and action. Something like, probably like this failure of the sensory motor schema, you know, that Deleuze speaks about. But there are interesting distinctions to be made. Now, I won't take more time. Like, Moinak actually mentioned Mukhamukham and Kabini Nadi Chuvannapol. Now, these two films, in some sense, signify two different moments of that figure. Mukhamukham is made later, but it refers to an earlier moment of politics. It's about the Communist Party, probably the Communist Party Marxist, which has already had electoral success, and there was disillusionment around it. And there is a certain kind of suggestive psychologization of the character, which stops at a certain point. Now, films like Abhinandi are quite different in the sense that there is a greater opacity of the figure, which does not allow the movement from the subjective to the personal that easily. You know. Now, this opacity has a history in literature which I do not want to speak about. It's based on an external point of view, like somebody outside the figure, looking at the figure as an object of admiration and inscrutability at the same time. Now, what Moinak tried to show was that, and also probably there is a kind of voyeuristic element in that, what Moinak tried to show in his presentation towards the end was how this kind of visibility leads to a certain presencing of something which cannot be a content, which cannot be an object of representation. Something is actually being visibilized there. And this is also there in the disconnect about topicality. You know? Topicality really is about this. That is, the present can appear only as something which can never be represented adequately. You can point to it, but it's in the failure that some presencing begins to happen. Now, of course, we saw that in a study, as well as in Padadik and all, we saw that this is supplemented in many of these films by images of newspaper footage, images of live footage, the printing press, typesetting, poster writing, these become important. They are signifiers in some sense which point to this difficulty of representing. And that seems to be an important issue which the discourse on new cinema touches upon, as well as the new cinema poses as a challenge before the audience. So I'll stop there.